So hi everyone, welcome to SDG Solutions. Welcome to our work. So we have, we are about to start the session. Before going to the session, I just briefly overview of the session. Okay, so today we are going to have the information about the Raspberry Pi mostly, and a little bit of overview of Internet of Things, and brief about the Internet of Things, like history and all. Okay, so myself Supriya Mollick, I work at Cognigent, and I have Suman. He is IoT developer from industry. Okay, so let's get started. I think we have pretty much time already. We have spent, it's 7 minutes past. Okay, so get started. Like Raspberry Pi, okay. Raspberry Pi is used for now, it is a device, a hardware platform for Internet of Things. Okay, so most of us may know or may not know. So, okay, so Internet of Things, what is Internet of Things? It's IoT, it's now a days is a burning topic. Okay, Internet of Things was started from like you can say it started from 1990, then slowly its development is going on. Like from there, from 1990, 1993, 1999, there are lots of huge success has been found in this area, Internet of Things. And finally, around 2008-09, those time, this Internet of Things has been successfully established in the industry. Okay, so what is actually in the Internet of Things? Initially, they used to RFID for the different type of object recognition and device recognition. So those RFID is being used in industry to identify different object. Okay, so they used to send the signal from, there is a requirement, like they will send the RFID data over the internet in another place or another computer. Okay, from there this development or this research began. Okay, so slowly they tried to connect two devices over the internet. First they tried to connect two devices, two different things in a single computer. Means from one device they will send a signal, and that signal will go to another device through a computer. After they tried to send signals between the two devices over the internet, and finally this IoT got established around 2008-09, when the Cisco Internet Business Solution Group like established that simply the point that two objects or two or multiple objects or thing, if it is connected over internet without any human intervention, then we are calling it as Internet of Thing. Okay, so now Internet of Thing has lot of layer. So Internet of Thing has very basic layer, very ground level layer is sensor hardwares. Sensors from where it actually our device sends the data. Like it can be a temperature sensor, it can be a moisture sensor, it can be any kind of sensor. After that, there should be one hardware platform where the sensor will send the data, and that platform will push the data over internet. Okay, now after that we have another layer. We are having the data, right? But we don't have any information from them. Like, so to process the data and make them in as information, we have a layer, like we have some analytics, we have some processing engine. Okay, so after that we have like some sort of software or user interface or application where we can see the data as the information. Okay, in a smart device we can interact from our mobile, right? So from mobile app is our one interface, and the AC temperature or room temperature is there is some sensor. So sensor, AC sensor or AC room temperature is picking up the data from the sensor, and then it is getting processed, and it is going over the internet to the end user's mobile app. Okay, so from there, from that particular platform, that particular hardware platform can process the data. It can be processed on cloud also. So there can be lots of possibility that as per your requirement or as per your use case, you can use the hardware platform to develop your IoT solutions. Okay, so you can take the data from sensors and you can process it like any IoT hardware platform. There are lots of IoT hardware platform like NodeMCU, Arduino, okay, Raspberry Pi. You can process the data, you can take out the information from them, and you can send it to another sensor. Okay, suppose your shipment has been, you do order in Amazon, right? So when you see that you get push notification from Amazon that your shipment is ready, again some time back you see push notification that order has been dispatched. Okay, so you don't think that these are being manually computed or manually sent. The moment they scan their QR code from their system, their scanner, that only in that moment it triggers a notification. Okay, it also triggers the notification to the supplier or to the transport services that this shipment is going to dispatch now, so be ready with your truck. Okay, so this type of network, this is endless opportunity we have. Okay, so I'm just giving an overview. So so today's session is a Raspberry Pi. So we have other hardware platform like Arduino, NodeMCU, ESP8266 microcontroller. So why we will choose Raspberry Pi? Okay, so that is our main focus. So Raspberry Pi, when it was founded, when it was discovered in UK in the Raspberry Found organization, it was developed as a single board computer. Okay, it's a kind of credit card size. If you have seen, if you have not seen, it's like a small, it's smaller than your wallet. Okay, so it is a very handy pocket size computer. It has every features. You can connect it through your computer, you can connect in your LED TV, you can with your USB devices, you can easily connect through Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, you can connect to the LAN cable. You will have access, you can connect your keyboard, mouse, and you can just do a computing. It has a full-fledged operating system. You can connect your keyboard, mouse, and you can just use it. Okay, so why choose Raspberry Pi? Because Raspberry Pi has high capacity. It's a very high capacity. It has very powerful computing processor. Okay, so that it can be easily plug and play, and you can use in your computational purpose. Maybe you want to browse data, you go over there, you open the browser and you just do your work. Okay, if you want to interface with some sensors, you just go, you can easily plug and play the sensors, you write lines of code, it will start working. It is very much handy. So we have lots of information is upcoming. Suman will tell you about all the details, all the interfaces. So I will not waste much time on this. So I will hand it over to you, Suman. Suman, you can start going in the details. Over to you, Suman. Thank you.
Okay. So good afternoon, everyone. Myself, SK Suman, the host of the today's webinar, and welcome you from each and every core of my heart. And I am very grateful to Supriya Mallik, as well as my heartfelt thanks to Arbik and Sankhadeep too. So as you all know that today's webinar is about Raspberry Pi, right? So it is very hot topic in our industry nowadays. So without wasting your time, let's go to the Raspberry Pi world. So I will share a PPT, and according to the PPT, I will try to cover its section. So, Hello. Am I audible?
Yeah, Suman, you are audible.
So my screen is visible, right?
Yes, you can see your screen.
Okay, thank you. Okay. So here is our Raspberry Pi. Okay, so this is the prototype. Okay, so going to the next session. Okay, so here we have few Raspberry Pi models. So these are like the first one. Sorry. The first one is Raspberry Pi 3. Second one is Raspberry Pi 0, Raspberry Pi 1, and a lot of models are there. But today's session we are going to use Raspberry Pi 4B. Okay, so you can check that. That is a very latest version. Okay. So you know that Raspberry Pi is a small single board computer. So by connecting peripherals like keyboard, mouse, display to the Raspberry Pi, it will act as a mini personal computer. So Raspberry Pi is popularly used for real-time image or video processing. And it is also an IoT-based application and robotic applications. Okay. So here is the most important things, that is the hardware part. So I will discuss one by one. So first of all, as you can see that there have lot of ports and lot of switches are there. So first of all, I want to say that about the HDMI. So actually HDMI stands for High Definition Multimedia Interface. So it is used for transmitting uncompressed video or digital audio data to the computer monitor, digital TV, etc. Generally, this HDMI port helps to connect Raspberry Pi to the digital television. You can connect your connect with your PC also. Okay, so next one is CSI camera interface. Actually, CSI stands for camera serial interface. So that interface provides a connection in between the Broadcom processor and Pi camera. Okay, now there have a port that is called DSI display interface. So DSI stands for display serial interface. So display interface is used for connecting LCD to Raspberry Pi using 15 pin ribbon cable. Okay, now there have some LED that is called power LED. It is a red color LED which is used for power indication, and this LED will turn on when power is connected to the Raspberry Pi. Okay, there have a section that is, you can say there are 40 pins headers are there. In the red color it is indicated 40 pins are there. I'm not going to discuss about it. I will discuss later. So I'm jumping to the next slide. Okay, set up with your networks. So it's very important, because if you don't know how to set up your Raspberry Pi, then it will not work. But before set up your Raspberry Pi with networks, I would like to tell something about its OS details. Okay. So actually, Raspberry Pi Foundation officially provides Debian-based Raspbian OS. Also, they provide Nobs OS for Raspberry Pi, and we can install several third-party versions of OS like Linux base. We can use the Windows IoT core, and a lot of things are there. So I am just simply going to the main side of Raspberry Pi. So you can get whatever I have told here. So Raspberry Pi, this is the official side of Raspberry Pi. Yeah, this is the main page of Raspberry Pi. And you can say, as I was talking about that, we are using Raspberry Pi 4, and this is the latest version, okay? So actually I was talking about the OS, right? So for that purpose, I have to go to the download section. Yeah. So as I was talking that Raspberry Pi Foundation officially, they provide Debian-based Raspbian. So you can see this is Raspbian. And also I told about the Nobs also. Okay. And also I talk about some third-party OS also. So here are these. a lot of things are there, a lot of ways are there. You can choose according to your requirement and you can install that. But in this session, we'll talk about the Raspbian. So, and I have to click on that. Yeah, this is the main page of Raspbian OS. See here, three OS are there. But one is Raspbian Booster Lite, Raspbian Booster with desktop, Raspbian Booster with desktop, and recommended software. So first one is most essential. You will get all kind of features in this OS. But rest of the others, you will not get all kind of features. Okay, a lot of things are missing there. So I will recommend it. Please download zip version, or you can, if you have a torrent, you can download it through torrent also. Okay, after downloading, I will tell about the next procedure. But I want to give some overview about the Raspberry Pi. So I'm again going to the main page. Okay. Yeah, if someone is interested to buy the Raspberry Pi, for their kind information, just go to the more information. And you can see there are a buy option. You can click on that. Okay, so there have some model number. So two types variant are available here. One is 4GB RAM version and 2GB RAM version. I will recommend 4GB RAM is much better than 2GB RAM, because using 4GB RAM, you can do a lot of things. You can do image processing, you can do IoT, AI related working, you can do IoT related working, and whatever you do in basically using Python, you can do using the 4GB RAM version. Okay, so I'll recommend it for this. And you have to choose the country. There are a lot of countries are there. As I'm belongs from India, so I'll choose India. Then few official websites are there. Five websites are there. You can go through it. Robo, I think it is a good. So go for it. So here is the link. You can purchase from here. So that's it. You can log in and you can get a lot of information if you are very much interested. So I'm not going to waste your time. I'm again coming back to the slide. Okay. So as we seen that our OS version is covered. Okay. So now I'm talking about the setup with networks. How we'll do that? First of all, with your Raspberry Pi, you have to connect a display. As I told in the another section, here you can see a HDMI port, right? This one, HDMI port. So using HDMI port, you can connect your Raspberry Pi to a display, or you can connect your Raspberry Pi to your smart TV also. Okay, so after connecting, you have to follow this kind of few instructions. Like first of all, you have to go to the Raspberry Pi home. And after that, you have to find the terminal and you have to write sudo nano slash etc and rest of the part. After that, you have to write the following things like SSID and PSK. SSID means your Wi-Fi user ID and PSK means your Wi-Fi password. So after that, you have to just save it. Don't worry, I will discuss and briefly. Okay, so next go into the second person. Okay, so Wi-Fi is connected with us, right? Now a question maybe arise, how you can enter to the Raspberry Pi? So there are several methods are there. I will discuss one by one. First of all, I'll talk about PuTTY. So here I have installed a PuTTY, you can see, and you can find it from your internet. After that, install it. So I'm just going to open it. Yeah. So PuTTY is come. Okay. So another software we also required, that is IP scanner. So what does it? Actually, IP scanner scan your whole local network. Okay. So before going to the IP address, I want to make sure that your Raspberry Pi and your system, I mean your laptop, should be connected in a same network. Otherwise, you can't handle. You can access from another website, like remote IO is there, but it is a kind of third-party application. They can snatch your data. So I will not recommend that third-party application. Better you use from your Putty or a lot of things I will discuss about that. So here, my Raspberry Pi is there, and its IP address is 192.168.43 and 140. So I will put here in Putty. In Putty, they have a host name or IP address. So I have to put my IP address. So I'm going to do that. It's 192.168.43.140. After that, you can see they have a port section. It is pre-written and it is 22. Okay, now a question may be arise. I can put here 20 or 21. No, you can't. Whatever you are seeing here, you have to keep it as it is. Okay, I will talk about the port whenever I will discuss about the networking section. So don't worry. Okay, so what I have to do after that, I have to select SSH, and after that I have to click on open. Whenever I'm click on open, a terminal arises in our display. Okay, now as you can see that it's talking about the login as. So whenever if you are a first time user, you are going to use the first time image, then they will ask about your username and password. Now you will be very little bit confused that what should be the password and user ID. For your kind information, every beginner or every who is using first time, for those person, the user ID and password will be same. The user ID will be Pi and password will be Raspberry Pi. So I'm going to put it. So Pi, after that hit enter. And it's asking about your password. As I told you that it is Raspberry Pi. Password is Raspberry Pi. So I'm going to put it. You cannot see my password because for security purpose. So I have put it. Now I'm going to hit enter. Okay. So successfully I have entered to the Raspberry Pi. Okay. Now if I want to see what are the elements inside my Raspberry Pi. Okay, for that purpose, I have to use ls. Ls is for listing. Okay, whenever I will press this command, I will enter this command, ls, it will show how many lists are there. So see, a lot of lists are there, like a few folders are there, few Pi file also there. Okay, so the blue colors is called the directory. Okay, blue colors, this one is called directory. Every blue colors, it is called like a directory. So if I want to enter to the directory, for that purpose, I have to use cd command. Cd stand for, it is used for directory actually. So after that, I want to enter to the desktop. So I have to write desktop. Then press enter. Again, I want to see how many elements are there. For that purpose, I have to use ls. There is only a text file is there.
Yeah, Suman, sorry to interrupt. Yeah. I was just reaching here, like this Raspberry Pi is the OS is the Raspbian OS. Okay, so yeah, so this is basically a Linux based OS. Okay, so these all the Linux related command actually can be used here. We are basically using, these are the Linux command, okay? Whatever we is using ls, ls-ltr, those are Linux command. So using those Linux command, we have to traverse in the inside the directory. Inside the directory, if you want to create any folder, if you want to go inside folder, back from the folder, you have to use the those Linux command, okay? Okay, Suman, you can continue.
Okay, thank you, sir. So a lot of people are getting very bored. I can understand that because I have opened a terminal and I am giving some command and I am accessing. A lot of people who are beginner, I think they are not getting my points. So okay, you have another way to enter in your Raspberry Pi. So for that purpose, I will recommend a software that is called, if you are a Mac user, then you have to install Microsoft eDesktop. Okay. So, and if you are a Windows user, then a pre-installed software is there. You can search from search button, just search remote desktop. You can find that software. So I'm going to click on that. Sorry. Yeah. So this is the interface. Yeah, this is the interface of the Microsoft Remote Desktop. So first of all, you have to set up some configuration. You have to do some configuration. For that purpose, you have to go to the new one and you have to click on that. And they are asking something like connection name and PC name. In connection name, whatever you can put here, you can put your name, you can put Pi, you can put Raspberry Pi, anything you can put here, and host name or IP address. As I told you that IP scanner should be installed in your system. Otherwise, you cannot find your IP address of your Raspberry Pi. So here it is, Raspberry Pi 192.168.43.140. So same thing, already I have configured my Microsoft remote desktop. I'll show that. Go to the edit section and you can see already I have put it connection name and the PC name. So nothing you have to do, just click on the settings. So it will redirect you to the Raspberry Pi homepage. So this is the
just to interrupt here. Basically what he was trying to everyone, basically what Suman was trying to show, like that is we have one option in our Windows remote desktop connection, right? So as this is a Suman is showing from Mac, that's why he has opened the different terminal. So but the same thing actually we have in Windows, like remote desktop connection. Okay, so I want to just give the similarity. I think if someone get confused, yes, this is a MacBook he is using, that's why it is appearing something different, but basically it is our remote desktop connection. Using that you can put the IP address and user ID password and you can log into the Raspberry Pi desktop. This is a desktop view actually. Yeah, Suman, go ahead.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, this is the home page of Raspberry Pi and you are most welcome to this Raspberry Pi world. Okay, so few things I'll tell about the Raspberry Pi. Here is a lot of function are there. So I'm going to this option and I have to click here. See, there is programming, education, office, internet, so many options are there. I'll discuss one by one. Program, there are a lot, these are totally our IDs. Okay, so you can see there have a Thony Python ID. So using this ID, you can easily make some script, Python script, obviously. So I'm going to show that. Yeah, already I have written a code. This is a print, welcome to Raspberry Pi world. And I have added two numbers. Okay, so I'm going to run that. Okay, so I'm going to run that. Yeah, it's welcome to Raspberry Pi world and 4. Okay, hold on. I am going to print some names from here. As I can say, see, Oishika Arobindo Pal. Okay, I'm going to write this one. Okay, delete everything. Now I am going to run it. It should be print. Yeah, here it is. So see, you can able to make some Python script also using this IDE. It is as like you can say that if you are a Python developer or if you are familiar with Python, then you heard about PyCharm, okay, and this kind of things I think you heard about. So this is a similar things. Actually, this is a kind of IDE. And okay, so now I'm going to the office section. These are something like you can say in your Windows section, you can see the Microsoft Word, PDF, everything. You can the PDF format, doc format, you can see now. You can do this using your MS Office. The same things are here. Here it's like library office base, library office, calc, and so many things are there. So usually you can open your PDF version, you can use your doc version, you can edit them. Okay, so this kind of things you can do here. This is the internet section. Here some pre-installed browser is here, like Chromium. It's like your Google Chrome browser. So I'm going to click on that. See, this is a Google Chrome browser. So you can search anything. Like I'm going to search google.com. Okay. Okay, so you can see. Okay. Now I'm going to the sound and video, VLC media player is there. Some graphics is there. Image viewer is an image viewer. Pre-installed games are there. And accessories, you already have calculator, file manager, PDF viewer, a lot of things are there. So you can do a lot of things. Whatever you do in your desktop, I mean, if you are a Windows user, so whatever you do in Windows, the same things you can do here. So it's basically a computer. In a simple language, I can explain that Raspberry Pi is a small desktop, or you can say
installing this OS, I need to have that OS into the Raspberry Pi board. So, I mean, is there any way you will push that into that motherboard?
No, Vijay, it's like not like that. It is like you use to install Windows operating system in your computer, right? So, from to install, either your CD drive or you've been using some pen drive, right? So from where you get the right? Either you download from somewhere internet or you procure from somewhere from internet, right? From that you get some image copy or some installation, some file copy, right? You will get. So you can download that OS from the Raspberry Pi website and you will have it in your computer. Then you plug the in your laptop or computer first, then write it in your chip or memory stick. First you have to download the OS from site into your laptop or into your computer, then you write the OS into the chip, then plug in the chip into the Raspberry Pi. Okay, so Suman, if it possible, can you go back to the Raspberry Pi?
Yeah, sure. The porch.
To die.
Open one image, any Raspberry Pi image.
Yeah. So first of all, you have to go to the download section. After that, you have to click Raspbian. Mm-hmm. You can also choose Noobs also, but I will recommend please install Raspbian because it is more comfortable. So after that, you will get three versions of Raspbian. I will recommend this one because all the features are included in this particular website, OS, but rest of the others, you will not get all the features. So first of all, you have to download this one, okay? To die. Okay. Continue, mister.
Okay, so actually this this you have to download in computer. Then you, from there your computer, you have to copy this thing in your chip. Okay. Then only you have to plug that chip into your Raspberry Pi. Someone open one picture of Raspberry Pi.
Yeah.
That board picture. From here also, here you can see there is one slot. Yeah, exactly. That is the chip. Yeah. This one is the chip. So here actually you have to plug the chip into the Raspberry Pi. So after that you power up the Raspberry Pi, it will turn up. Then you can connect through the SSH terminal, or you have some HDMI cable. Then just plug in the HDMI cable with your TV or computer. You can see the Raspberry Pi. You can see the desktop. You can see the Raspberry Pi desktop. So is that answer your question, Bijan?
Yeah, I got it.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else, any question? Okay, Suman, I think we are good to continue then.
Okay. So this is the most interesting part. It's called GPIO ports. As I told at the beginning time that I will discuss about this later. So for better understanding, I'm going to share in picture. Sorry, not this one. Yeah. This is the total 40 pins are there. Okay. So there have total 1, 2, 3, and 4 supply ports are there. 2, 3 volts. I mean 3.3 volts. Here it is, and here it is, and 2 5-volt supply is there, and total 8 ground pins are there. Like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Okay. Now I will talk some another ports. Like if you want to interface some I2C protocol with GPIO pins, then you can use also. So in I2C communication, we can see there have two particular pins are there. One is SDA pins and another one is SCL pins. Don't worry, I will discuss about the I2C communication. So I'm just telling about this. So this section is called I2C communication sections. And if you want to use SPI communication, for that purpose, you have to use pin number 24 and pin number 26. This is the SPIO protocol. And if you want to use URAT protocol, then you have to use pin number 8 and pin number 10. Pin number 8 is transmitter and pin number 10 is receiver pin. Okay, as well as if you want to use MOSI, MISO and SCLK, then also you can use, here it is, pin number 19, pin number 21 and pin number 23. So that's it about the GPIO pin, and I will give some hands-on demo also, so don't worry. So, okay, into the next slide. Okay, so here it is. So one LED and one push button is connected with the GPIO pin. Now you know that LED has two legs. One is called anode and another one is called cathode. So here cathode is connected with the ground and the anode is connected with the signal pins, then GPIO pins. Is pin number 32 actually, not 32, it's, I have to calculate, it's 32, pin number 32. And you can see that between the signal pin, the GPIO pin and the LED leg, there have a resistor and it is the 330 ohm. You always keep it in your mind that whenever you are going to connect any sensor, an LED, everything, with your GPIO pins, you have to have used register. Otherwise, your sensor or your LED or any accessories may burn, or it may damage also. Okay. So now I am going to show some hands-on project and how I can control LED on-off using Raspberry Pi and Python coding. Okay. So before going to the coding section, I want to say one thing that in this Raspberry Pi, you can use a lot of languages also. You can use Java, you can use Python, you can use C, you can use C++, lots of language you can use according to your requirement. But here I am trying to, actually I am more familiar with Python. That's why I will handle everything. I will show everything in using Python. Okay. And you can do also using C, but here I also in Python coding. So for that purpose, I have to open my terminal. This is called terminal. Okay. Now after that, I have to list out my elements. So I have to press ls. Okay. Now I want to my all programs I have written in IoT. In IoT folder, that means in IoT directory. So I have to move on IoT. That's why I will use cd command, then IoT, hit enter. Again, I want to see what is inside the IoT, ls. Okay, now I want to go to the program section. Now, here a lot of things are there. Directly, I'm going to the LED part. Okay, now I want to see some. Okay, the three programs are there. Three Python scripts are there. Also, one basic code, that is blink_test.py. So first of all, I will show you what I have written actually. Okay, so for that purpose, for editing purpose, basically, if you want to edit your code from terminal, you have to use sudo space nano. After that, your Python script name. So here my Python script is blink_test.py. Hit enter. Okay. So I have import some GPIO pins and time. Okay. And this is the set mode that I have initialized. And this is the setup. Setup means your sensor is in which mode? It is in output mode or it is in input mode? As my I'm going to handle my LED, so it is all about the output. That's why I have fixed here output. If your sensor will act as input, you have to write here IN only. Okay, this is a under the while loop. I have written some code for output purpose, and I am printing something. Whenever LED will be glow, and in your terminal, it will show LED is on. Whenever it will goes off, then it will show LED is off. And both things will be happen in an interval, in a particular time. That means it will happen within 2 seconds. So I'm just closing it. For that purpose, you have to use Control X. Now I want to run my code. Okay. So if whenever you will run any code from your terminal, you have to use first Python. After that, your script name. Here, my script name is blink_test.py. Now I want to hit enter. See, my LED is blinking. Now I will show you that. Hold on. My mobile screen is visible.
Hello? Yes.
Okay. So you can see it is going on and off within 2 second interval. And whenever it is on, then it is showing in the terminal LEDs on. Whenever it is going off, in terminal it is showing LED off. You can see that. LED is on and off. So is it clear? So any question apart from this?
Suman, can you show that just little bit, the hardware, the wiring mechanism
that you have? Sure, sir. Okay, so this is my LED actually. Okay, so this one is anode part and this one is cathode part. Okay, so in anode part I have connected a resistor. You can see that a resistor is here. Is it visible?
Sumar, keep the mobile steady. It is flickering. Not exactly. Bring the mobile up a little bit up. Okay. Yeah. Now it is visible. Yeah. You can continue.
So this is the resistor and this one the LED anode part, okay, and this one the cathode part. Okay, so I have connected this pin, this anode part, with LED 40, GPIO 40. So you can see this is the GPIO 40, the blue one. This is the blue one. This is pin number 40. Okay. And this gray one is ground port. So I have connected to the ground GPIO port. So now is it clear? I think everybody got it. Okay, so I'm going to turn off my screen.
Raspberry Pi a little bit more.
Sorry?
Just focus your camera on the Raspberry Pi, the hardware, so that everyone can see and enjoy the actual device. Okay.
So this is my Raspberry Pi actually.
Yeah, exactly. So here you can see the interfaces, right? So in the left hand side you can see the GPIO pins. Over there there's a Ethernet cable, Ethernet plug. You can
this one.
After that we have four USB
plug. This one.
Yeah. After that we have an audio pin.
This one.
Yeah. Beside that we have the camera serial.
Yeah.
After
this
that
one.
Micro USB.
Yeah.
Okay. So these are the interfaces.
Okay. I'm closing my sharing.
So anyone has any questions so far? Yes, please feel free to ask. Don't hesitate.
So may I continue?
Yeah, Suman, yes, sure. You can continue.
Okay. So I'm going to close this section. Again, I'm returning to the slide section. Okay. Okay. Now interfacing with I2C. As I told that later I will discuss about the I2C. So first of all, you should have knowledge about the I2C, but I'm not going to discuss about briefly because it's not possible. If you are very much interested to know about the I2C, then go to Google and search it. But I'm going to give an overview about I2C. So actually, the full form of I2C is inter-integrated circuit and is a synchronous serial protocol that communicates data between two devices. And it is a master-slave protocol which may have one master or many master and many slaves, where SPI has only one master. And it is generally used for the communication over broad distance. And the I2C device has 7-bit or 10-bit unique addresses. Okay, and I2C is used in many applications like reading RTC. RTC means real-time clock. Okay, so everybody is in a house having a digital clock, right? So in digital clock, RTC module is used for real-time updation. And I2C LCD, and I will talk about the I2C LCD, and I will show a hands-on a project also. And it is also used in sensors module like gyroscope, magnetometer, etc. And I2C is also known as two-wire interface that is called TWI protocol. Okay, so I have told about the theory part. Now I'm going to the practical part. So if you want to interface with I2C protocol, first of all, you have to enable. And you can see a few pictures are here. It is some giving some instruction, and I'll do everything one by one. So first of all, you have to enable the I2C protocol. For that purpose, you have to again go to the Raspberry Pi home. Okay, then again, open your terminal. And you have to go to the settings sections. For that purpose, you have to write, okay, make me full screen. Okay, for that purpose, you have to write some code, I mean, some instruction, that is sudo raspi config and hit enter. And here it is the settings. A lot of things are there. As we are talking about the interfacing, so I2C interfacing. So I will go to the interfacing sections. So here it is, interfacing options. Hit enter. Okay, there are a lot of things are there for interfacing purpose: camera, SSH, BNC, SPI. When I was discussing about the GPIO pins, I told that SPI protocol, I2C protocol. So here it is, SPI protocol, and just below, I2C protocol is also there. So first of all, I have to enable the I2C protocol. For that purpose, I have to select it. So hit enter, and it's asking about enable, yes or no. I have to do yes, definitely. Then the ARM I2C interface is enabled, press OK. Now I want to quit from the settings. For that purpose, I have to finish. So it's finished. Okay. So finally, I have successfully enabled the I2C protocol. Now, again, I am going to share something. I'm going to share my screen. So my screen is visible. Hello.
Yes.
Yeah, just a minute. Actually, some people has the visibility issue. Okay. Just a minute. Hold on. Okay.
I can see.
Raghav, are you able to see now? You can. Okay. Okay, so anyone have the issue? Okay, so you just click on the ACG solutions, okay, SK Suman's screen, and click on the pin icon. It will appear in your desktop in last view. Okay, okay, okay. I think Suman, now it is all set. You can continue.
Okay, so this is the LCD. Okay, and the actually LCD having total 14 pins, so it is more difficult to handle total 14 pins. That's why we have plugged in a I2C communication protocol. So here it is, and it has only two pins are there. Okay, I'll show that.
It is getting blurred, Suman. Keep a distance. Keep a distance. It is getting blurred. Now it is fine.
Okay. So first one is ground. Second one is VCC, and third one is SDA, and after that it is SCL. When I was discussing about the I2C protocol, then I think I told about the SDA pin and SCA pin. So I have to connect these pins. So here, all the pins are connected. You can see the red one. First one is 5 volt. Second one is the yellow one, ground. Okay, and the SDA pin and SCA pin also connected. Okay, so now I'm going to plug the ground pin. So as you can see, our power has come in your display. So it is visible?
Yeah.
Okay. So, okay. Now I'm going to stop. I will come back again.